Welcome. I'm Heather McCullough, Director of the Tax Policy Project. I'll be moderating today's webinar, Who Benefits from Federal Tax Subsidies? As you know, this webinar is co-hosted by PolicyLink, CFED, and the Asset Funders Network, along with the seven organizations listed on this next slide. I'd like to thank our partners and give a special thanks to PolicyLink for managing the webinar technology. Let me quickly review our agenda. I'm going to start us out with some framing comments and introductions of our speakers. Then you'll hear from our four speakers, and after that, we'll turn to questions from all of you. Please submit your questions throughout the webinar, and we'll do our best to answer as many of them as we can during the Q&A. But please know that we have almost 800 people registered, so if we don't get to your question during the webinar, feel free to include it in your comments when you get the pop-up survey after the webinar, and I'll do my best to get you the answers. So let me give you a little bit of context for our discussion. As you all know, there's been a national dialogue about the causes and effects of income and wealth inequality, including attention to the role of the U.S. tax code. As you'll hear today, the federal tax code provides more than $1 trillion in tax subsidies each year. These are known to policymakers and economists as tax expenditures because they're a form of spending through the tax code. More than a half trillion dollars of these public subsidies help households to build wealth each year through homeownership, retirement savings, higher education, and other subsidized savings and investment, but wealthier households receive the vast majority of the benefits. Our goals for today's webinar are to help you understand what tax expenditures are and how they work, who benefits and who doesn't, proposals for reform, and ways to advance equitable tax policies in the months and years ahead. So let me introduce you to our presenters. Jeremy Greer is the Director of Government Affairs at CFED. In this role, he leads the Policy and Government Affairs team and is responsible for developing and executing CFED's policy agenda. Lewis Brown is a Senior Program Associate at PolicyLink, where he conducts research related to tax policy. Lewis also works to advance public policies that improve outcomes for boys and men of color. Benjamin Harris is the policy director of the Hamilton Project, a fellow in economic studies, and deputy director of the Retirement Security Project at the Brookings Institution. His primary areas of focus are tax, budget, and retirement security. And finally, Amanda Feinstein is a senior program officer at the Walter and Elise Haas Fund, where she manages a grant-making program that helps low-income families achieve economic security and upward mobility through quality employment and asset-building opportunities. Amanda is a steering committee member of the National Asset Funders Network and has co-chaired AFN's tax reform initiative, the Tax Policy Project, which I direct, for the past 2 years. So now I'm going to turn it over to Jeremy to start off with the presentations.
Thanks, Heather. So what I'm going to do today is talk a bit about some work that CFED has done related to the way the tax credits are sent and tax benefits are sent throughout the tax code, the distribution of those tax benefits, and how they support the asset building activities of Americans. So to give you some background on how long CFED has been at this, so in 2010 we published a report called Upside Down, and what that report really illuminated was the extent to which the tax code is used for social policy to really help Americans build assets and wealth, to really expand opportunities around home ownership, retirement, savings and investments, and higher education. So more recently in September, we introduced and published a update to that report that identified a lot of these benefits in the tax code and how they're distributed, but also talked a bit about what are some of the policy solutions that could address some of the problems. So what I'm going to do today is talk a bit about the scale of those tax benefits, the distribution, and what some of the policy solutions are moving forward. So to start with, I really want to open up with talking about the scale and size of the tax spending that's happening. And as Heather mentioned, this is spending. This is no different than spending money on the spending side of the ledger, where you see all of the social programs, all of the things that the government does. And what you find is that if you just isolate the asset building tax programs, which are to support homeownership, retirement, savings and investments, and higher education, there is more spent just through the tax code than 14 cabinet level agencies. That includes all of the HUD programs, all the health and human services programs, all the Veterans Affairs, basically every discretionary budget that is not the Department of Defense. And another key difference with tax spending than when you look at the programs on the spending side, well, the programs on the spending side, due to sequestration, the Budget Control Act and others, it's expected to see a decline over time in the size of the spending programs. This is not the case with the tax programs. These tax programs are expected to rise, as you see in this bar chart, on into the future with nothing really set in stone to stop them from growing in size. So that's the sheer size. So we've established that these are big, big spending programs on the tax side. So then the next question you ask is, how is it distributed? And what we found is that, hence the name of the report, it's upside down. Basically, the higher income you are, the more benefits you get from the tax code. And if you look at this chart, what you find is that the top 20% of taxpayers receive much more combined than basically the lower 80% of all taxpayers. And if you look at just the top 1%, they receive more than any other quintile in the income distribution and tax benefits. So what's key here is that basically the more income you have, the more wealthy you are as a taxpayer, the more you get back through the tax spending programs. These aren't programs that are meeting the most needy. They're ones that are supporting those at the higher end. In real dollar terms, that means that if you're in the top 0.1% of taxpayers, you receive about $33,000 a year in tax benefits. You could buy another car, a Cadillac even, a luxury car with that. And if you are in the bottom 20%, you receive about $77 in tax benefits. You wouldn't even have enough money to fill the tank of that Cadillac if you were driving that higher-end wage earner to one of their errands. So why is this? Why is this the way it is? And I'm not going to go into a lot of detail around this because Lewis is going to talk a bit about what some of these things are. But the reason that this happens is not just because of what people are paying and because people are wealthy, but it's because of how the tax code is structured. It's structured in a way that certain people do not have access to certain benefits, and if they do, they get it at a rate that is not as supportive than if they're high income. And here are two tables. So two examples are, say you were to look at deductions, and deductions are somewhat skewed to begin with, because if you get a standard deduction, which is something that that people with lesser tax liability tend to have, you wouldn't be able to access many of the benefits that you see in this chart. But just to say that you did, if you were a taxpayer in a 15% rate bracket, and if you were a higher income taxpayer in the 39.6% rate bracket with the same asset portfolio, you could see you would get much less in benefit than if you are a lower moderate income family than if you are a high income family. This is also the case where the distribution is uneven, the larger the asset that you have. So basically, for example, if you had a bigger house with a higher set of mortgage interest, you would receive a much larger mortgage interest deduction than someone on the lower end of the tax scale. So what are some of the things you can do like this? So this is in this slide, there's a whole slew of policies, and many of them come from work that the Tax Policy Project has done to begin to identify where in the tax code some of these problems can be solved. But I'm just going to identify a couple that I think are of note. In the area of home ownership, one thing that many people are aware of and know is that the mortgage interest deduction just isn't a very good way to incentivize home ownership, if that is the goal. And a better way to incentivize home ownership that would be more equitably distributed to people on the high end and people on the low end would be a first-time down payment credit. One, because credits versus deductions tend to reach more taxpayers, and then also we know that one of the major hurdles to home ownership is actually getting the capital to make a down payment on a home. Another policy that we think could move the needle is the Savers Credit, which is right now the only credit that provides an incentive to low-income people to save in a retirement account. Problem with that credit today is that it is not refundable. It's not a credit that you can get if you don't have any tax liability. Therefore, many low-income people, taxpayers, can't even access the credit, even if they are putting money into those types of retirement accounts. Another problem with it is because of where the income distribution is cut, a lot of people right on the cusp are not able to access it, or they're not able to take full advantage of it because of the refundability issues. And finally, the one other policy that I like to highlight is the American Opportunity Tax Credit, another tax credit already in place to support low-income people accessing higher education. Problem being is you can only get the tax credit if you're already in college, which really does little for young people that are looking to move into or create access to higher education in a way that they couldn't otherwise. So with that, I'm going to end, and here's my contact information, also the contact information from my colleague Ezra Levin and co-author of Upside Down to Right Side Up, the report that you will get through this webinar. And if you have any questions, feel free to reach out to either of us, and I'm going to send it back to Heather. Thank you.
Great. Thanks so much, Jeremy. We're getting a lot of questions about the slides, and you will all be getting copies of them in an email after the webinar. They will also be available online, and we'll have that URL coming up again at the end of the presentations. So now I'd like to turn it over to Lewis Brown from PolicyLink. Go ahead, Lewis.
Thank you, Heather. Good morning to those on the West Coast. And
excuse me, Lewis. Could you speak a little bit louder? We can't really hear you.
Sure. Can you hear me now?
Better.
Okay.
Yes. Thanks.
Okay. Great. So, good morning to those of you on the West Coast, and good afternoon to everyone on the East Coast. I'm very excited to be here with you all to discuss who benefits from federal tax subsidies. So let's get to it. We know that for many of us, tax is sort of a head scratcher. Their taxes are confusing, they're complicated, but as Heather and Jeremy alluded to, this issue, tax subsidies in particular, is so important that we at PolicyLink and others who have been involved in this space, like CFED and others, have felt that it's important to make sure that people understand what the tax code is, what tax subsidies and tax expenditures are, and who benefits from them. So PolicyLink developed a primer for advocates called Building an Equitable Tax Code. And we had three different aims. The first is to demystify the tax code, so to provide a basic understanding of tax subsidies. The second was to describe who benefits from them by income, race, and ethnicity. And the third was to outline steps that advocates can take to build a more equitable tax code. The details of that primer are what I'm going to go through today. But before I do that, I just want to step back a little bit and talk about, you know, why are we talking about the tax code? Why are we talking about this head scratcher of a thing? Why are we talking about race? So we're talking about the tax code and about race for two essential reasons, and there are others, but they're two essential ones. The first is that the individual income tax code can provide a powerful tool for closing the income and racial wealth gaps and for building a more equitable economy. So we know that over the last few decades, more and more money, more and more wealth has been concentrated at the top and less at the bottom. We also know that racial wealth gaps the gap between how much white households hold and how much households of color hold in wealth is wide and growing. At the same time, we also know, as Jeremy indicated, that there are substantial amounts of money, hundreds of billions of dollars, over $1 trillion actually, of money that's being filtered through the tax code, $540 billion of which is for building wealth. Yet, we are not talking about the tax code in the way that we should, and that's part of the reason why we're holding this webinar. And also, until recently, we haven't talked a lot about how tax subsidies are distributed among racial and ethnic groups. And while the research is hard to do on the distribution of tax expenditures among racial and ethnic groups, because the IRS doesn't keep data by race, we felt it was important to at least start that conversation. So what are tax subsidies? As Jeremy and Heather said, tax subsidies, tax expenditures are spending through the code. Another way of saying that is, tax subsidies are provisions of the tax code that provide financial assistance in the form of saving. So basically, there are certain provisions of the code that through some mechanism or another, reduce your tax bill, lower it from what it otherwise would have been. And so there are three different ways that that happens. So tax savings are created by reducing the amount of income an individual can be taxed on, by lowering the tax rate applied to your income, or actually by directly reducing a household's tax bill dollar for dollar. And I'll get it more into what that means. So there are four categories of tax subsidies or tax expenditures. Now, some analyses include additional categories, but we've gone with four. Some go with four, the Congressional Budget Office, for example, and we've decided to follow that route. So exclusions. What are exclusions? Exclusions are certain types of income that are exempt from taxation. They're typically not even reported on your tax return. So when you think about exclusions, think about your contributions to your 401k account, right? So that money is not counted as part of your income when you file your taxes. And that ends up lowering your tax bill because the tax rate is applied to a lower level of income. Deductions are expenses incurred by taxpayers throughout the year that can be used to reduce your taxable income. So when I talk about deductions here, I'm talking mainly about itemized deductions. An example of that is the interest you pay on a home mortgage. Deductions, like exclusions, lower the amount of income that is subject to taxation, thereby lowering your tax bill. So when households file their tax returns, they must either claim the standard deduction, which is an amount that the IRS sets every year, or they must itemize deductions. People typically itemize deductions if the level, complete level of itemized deductions are higher than the standard deduction. Preferential rates. So preferential rates are lower rates applied to income from stocks, bonds, and other qualified investments. So if you think about the dividends that you receive from a share of Coca-Cola, right? If that dividend meets certain criteria, if it's a qualified dividend, then the tax rate that you pay on that is lower than the tax rate that you would pay on the money that you get from your employer. Credits. Credits actually directly offset your tax bill dollar for dollar. So what that means is that if you get a $200 credit, your tax bill goes down by $200, right? And so there are two types of credits. There's refundable credits and non-refundable credits. So an example of a refundable credit is the earned income tax credit, which I'm sure a lot of you are aware of. A refundable credit can result in a refund if your liability, your tax bill, is lower than the credit. So if you have a $200 tax bill, the $300 credit, you get a $100 refund. Non-refundable credit cannot result in a refund, but otherwise it operates like a credit. So the different ways in which these categories of expenditures operate lead to different sort of distributions among different income groups. So here you see a table, and this is borrowed from the Center on Budget and Policy Priorities, that shows that if you're in the 0% tax bracket and you get a deduction, or you have a value of deduction of $2,000 or exclusion, you get $0, right? You get nothing back. But if you have a refundable credit of $2,000, then you get a credit of $2,000, right? And so I won't go through all of this, but what you can see is the way the deductions, exclusions, and credits operate leads to a different distribution for different income groups. So what does that mean in the aggregate? What does that operation, what does that structure mean in the aggregate for those different different types of expenditures? So what we see here is the preferential rates on capital gains and dividends, right? So we said that what that is lower rates apply to gains on dividends from stocks and income from stocks and bonds and other qualified investments. Almost 100% of that goes to people in the top 20% of the income bracket. And in this case, that's people making over $103,000 a year, approximately. Exclusions, which is the biggest category, almost 67% of that goes to people making over 20%. I mean, in the top 20% of earners. And with itemized deductions, $147 billion, 81% of that goes to people in the top 20% of earners. What you also see is that for capital gains and dividends, itemized deductions and exclusions, very little of that goes to people in the bottom 20% of the income spectrum. But once you get to non-refundable credits and refundable credits, as you can see, the bottom 20% gets a greater share of the savings produced by those expenditure categories. So what does that mean in terms of race? So as I said at the outset, it's very difficult to get a sense of how tax expenditures are distributed among income groups, among racial and ethnic groups, because the IRS doesn't keep data by race. So what we did was we took a look at the demographic composition of each of those income quintiles that I just discussed in the past slide. And so what we can see is that minorities, or households of color, make up a greater percentage of the income quintiles that they receive more of the savings from refundable and non-refundable credits, and less of the income quintiles that receive exclusions, itemized deductions, and preferential rates. And so basically what this means is households of color are likely to receive less from itemized deductions, exclusions, and preferential rates, and more likely to benefit from tax credits, both refundable and non-refundable. So I'm not going to go through this, but these are some reasons why households of color don't benefit from tax subsidies. For example, the mortgage interest and property tax deduction, 73% of whites own homes, whereas only 43% of blacks and 46% of Latinos own homes. So the takeaways are that itemized deductions, exclusions, and preferential rates largely benefit the top 20% of earners. Households of color are more likely to benefit from credits, non-refundable credits, and less likely to benefit from other types of deductions. Refundable credits and non-refundable credits. Finally, households of color do not benefit from major asset building major asset building subsidies. So, what can we do to build a more equitable tax code? So, Jeremy went through sort of a list of policy proposals, but what I like to do is propose a different approach. And so, I think two of the things that we need to do are, one, turn itemized deductions into exclusions. Itemized deductions and exclusions into credits. For example, change the mortgage interest deduction into a credit, right, or a low-income home buyer tax credit, so that low-income folks and households of color can actually benefit from it. The other thing that we could do is create more refundable credits by developing new ones or making some non-refundable credits refundable. So, for example, Jeremy mentioned the Savers credit. What we could do is make that credit refundable and thereby providing a greater benefit to low-income households and households of color. So if you'd like to learn more about the tax primer and about the information that I discussed today, you can view it at the link shown on this slide. And if you have any questions, you can give me a call or send me an email at the information here. You could also contact Heather McCulloch, who is my co-author on the tax primer. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, Lewis. Now we're going to turn it over to Ben Harris with the Brookings Institution. Go ahead, Ben.
Thanks, Heather. Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. I'm going to talk about the same topic, who benefits from federal tax subsidies, but I'm going to spend some time presenting some new research that gets at many of the questions we heard from Lewis and Jeremy. I'll talk quickly about the motivation for this research and very briefly about the methodology, and then we'll get into some of the results. As Lewis mentioned, one of the key challenges when looking at tax expenditures is quantifying the link between who benefits and different demographic characteristics, different racial characteristics, perhaps geographic characteristics. It's really hard to study this because, as Lewis noted, the IRS, when they release their data, they don't release it along with racial information because they don't have it, and they don't release it along with geographic information because of privacy concerns. So we know, as you've just heard, we know that we spend about $1 trillion to the tax code to support all these various programs that we deem to be worthwhile. We don't have a great idea about who benefits. One way of getting at this question is to look at zip code level data. So the IRS releases information each year on the tax-paying characteristics of each zip code. We can look at each zip code, we can merge that with different demographic information from the American Community Survey and get an idea about who's winning and losing from these various tax expenditures. So what we're doing is we're looking at zip code level data. So we don't have data on each household, but the unit of observation here is the zip code. So you take a particular zip code, we know how much all of the taxpayers in that given zip code benefit from a given tax expenditure, and then we also know the demographic characteristics of that zip code, and of course we know where that zip code is located. So just to emphasize, the unit of observation here is the zip code, not the taxpayer. We try to get at three different tax expenditures in this round of research. The first is the earned income tax credit. This brief came out 2 days ago and is posted on the Tax Policy Center website. A second area we're looking at is the mortgage interest deduction. That brief will probably come out this evening or tomorrow morning. And then the third one is we're looking at capital gains, the preferential rate on capital gains, and that should come out next week. So the first one was the earned income tax credit, and the earned income tax credit is one of the best ways we have at getting at poverty interventions and helping to subsidize work to raise incomes of low-income families. And this figure that you're seeing hammers home the point how important the earned income tax credit is to zip codes that have high levels of poverty. So all this shows, and it's nothing that people don't know, but what is really surprising is the magnitude of this association. All this shows is the relationship between the EITC claiming rate, which is just the percent of taxpayers who are claiming the EITC, and the percent of families that are below the poverty line. So if you just want to take a sort of look across the horizontal axis, you can see that as we go up as far as the percent of families that are in poverty, and this is the official poverty line, not the supplemental poverty measure. As we go up and as you go from 10 to 20 to 30% of families below the poverty line, you see a very steady increase in the EITC claiming rate. And all this does is make the point that, look, the EITC is really important to those zip codes that have high levels of poverty. Going to the next figure, figure two, we show this as sort of a different way. The mean EITC claiming rate is about 19%. But you can separate the zip codes into different buckets by poverty rate. And just looking all the way on the right, you see that those zip codes have really high poverty levels, that 50% and above have EITC claiming rates of about 50%. And if you want to look on the left, you can see those zip codes that have low poverty incidents, they have very low EITC claiming rate. And again, all this does is hammer home how important the EITC is as an anti-poverty initiative. We talked about race. We talked about how difficult it was to sort of quantify the association between different racial characteristics of taxpayers and who's benefiting. So what we did is we went ahead and we separated out all the zip codes just into two groups, those that have EITC claiming rates of 40% and above, and those that have EITC claiming rates of 40% and below. And you can see how different these two groups are. So the teal line are those zip codes that have EITC claiming rates of up to 40%. And you see that those tend to be much more white. They just have less African-American population, slightly different Asian population. But basically what you see is you see that zip codes that have a high proportion of African-American residents really benefit from the EITC. So moving on, we're going to see a few figures here on the mortgage interest deduction. And you know, one of the startling things about the mortgage interest deduction is how concentrated it is among a few select zip codes. So what we're looking at here is we're looking at zip codes that have various AGIs, adjusted gross income. That's essentially we're looking at a measure of income. And what you see here is you see that it's really kind of shocking, and sorry, one of the axes got cut off on this chart, but what you see that about half of the mortgage interest deductions are claimed in about 10% of zip codes. The 10% of zip codes that claim the highest amount of mortgage interest deductions get about half of the overall deductions that are claimed. So what you're seeing is it's just, you know, a very small select number of zip codes are really benefiting from the mortgage interest deduction, and others aren't. And we also have a breakdown by race in the forthcoming brief. Here I'll show you sort of the breakdown by different household characteristics. As we did with the EITC, we're breaking it down into two different groups. So those zip codes that have a mortgage interest deduction claiming rate of at least 40% or 40% and less, and those that have a claiming rate of 40% and more. And you see that the type of families that tend to benefit from the mortgage interest deduction tend to be married families, and those families that don't have high mid-claiming rates have sort of different household characteristics. They're either living in a non-family household. Female household or families with no husband present tend to benefit less from the mortgage interest deduction. So it's not just a story about race. It's also a story about household composition, and we also do breakdowns by age and other different demographic characteristics. But, you know, just to sum up, I think that I sort of want to echo the comments of the prior presenters and say this is a really important question, thinking about who benefits from tax expenditures beyond just income characteristics that we know, but getting into other things like geographic characteristics and household characteristics and racial characteristics. So my hope is that this round of research, which will come out this week and next week, will help get to that question. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, Benjamin. We appreciate that. And now we're going to shift over to Amanda Feinstein, Senior Program Officer with the Walter and Elise Haas Fund. Amanda?
Hi. Thank you, Heather. So my comments are going to be kind of stepping up a few thousand feet. With a bit of a recap and a frame. As Heather noted, I'm on the steering committee of the Asset Funders Network and also a senior program officer at the Walter and Elise Haas Fund. I think it's worth just saying briefly that Asset Funders Network is a national membership organization of foundations that invest in programs and policy work to expand economic opportunity and financial security for all Americans. We have regional affiliate chapters that the organization has a national reach. The Haas Fund is a regional foundation that is part of that network and has a similar mission. Like so many foundations and nonprofits across the country, the Walter and Elise Haas Fund has worked hard and invested heavily in building the infrastructure of asset building programs and policies that help low and moderate income people increase their financial capability, save money towards their goals, and make key investments in things like businesses, homes, and education, and other assets that people value and strive for to improve the quality of their lives. Tremendous progress has been made nationally by hundreds of effective and innovative asset building organizations that touch the lives of tens of thousands of people in profound ways every year. And yet, in the aggregate, low and moderate income people in America are losing ground. Economic inequality has grown to extremes not seen since the Great Depression. The wealthiest 20% of households receive more than half of the national income, which is an increase of 18% since 1970. And the bottom 60% of households receive just 26% of the national income, which is a decrease of 19% since 1970. The distribution of wealth is even more dramatically skewed, with the wealthiest 5% of households now owning 70% of the nation's wealth. And at the same time, almost half of American families are liquid asset poor, meaning they don't have sufficient savings to survive even at the poverty level for 3 months should they lose their income. I say this as a preface to why this tax reform work is so important. Get my slide going here. So as my colleagues on the call have already explained, the benefits of existing tax subsidies or expenditures largely accrue to the wealthiest households. We have $500 billion of saving and investment incentives baked into the tax code that by design are helping wealthy individuals and families keep more of the income, of their income. Compounding this dynamic is the fact that the marginal tax rate for the highest earners has dropped from roughly 70% before 1981 to just under 40% today. The upshot is that the tax code incentivizes people with wealth to build more wealth while doing little or nothing to help the large majority of low and moderate income, households keep more of their income for spending and saving. The other reason this work is so important is that, and because it and should have some appeal to policymakers on the left and the right, is that asset subsidies are fundamentally inefficient. A central reason, as others on the call have explained, for having tax deductions, exemptions, credits, or preferential tax rates is to incentivize certain behaviors that we as a society believe are good for the long-term economic stability of families and the national economy. Things like buying homes, paying for quality child care for our children, sending them to college, putting money aside for retirement or emergencies. Many higher income taxpayers are simply shifting their existing savings and investments into tax-preferred vehicles tied to these asset goals. An analysis of this issue by Urban Institute showed that there is nominal new savings by the wealthy that results from tax subsidies. Lower and middle income taxpayers, on the other hand, the folks for whom asset building tax incentives were intended, are more likely to increase their savings activities with the help of appropriate financial incentives. And yet these households are not reached or incentivized to save. So this issue of inefficiency is key. Finally, tax reform and the nation's tax system is the largest and most far-reaching mechanism for helping Americans build financial assets. Key changes in the structure and focus of specific tax incentives will have a profound impact on the economic well-being of millions of low and moderate income Americans. So as the previous speakers have done a great job talking about the kinds of tax reforms that we need, I want to share with you a set of principles developed by the Tax Policy Project, which I'll talk more about in a moment. That we believe should guide our assessment of which kinds of tax reforms move us forward and which set us back. First is we need tax policy reforms that will significantly increase economic benefits that accrue to lower income households and households of color. We need policy changes that have a significant and sustainable impact on the relative economic mobility of lower income households and households of color. And in terms of design features, we need tax policy changes that are easy to understand, easy to apply for, and easy to enroll in. So there are some core strategies that we should talk about. Each of the previous speakers has touched on some of the specific tax reform proposals. You know, suffice it to say there are a myriad possible ways to tweak the tax code to the betterment or detriment of lower and moderate income households. The tax code is so complex. We definitely need to have the tax reform experts and scholars on our team who can dig into the nuances. But I think that there are a few core strategies that we as generalists, I put myself in the generalist category, would do well to sort of hold on to and be prepared to talk about. And so these ideas are something of a recap of what you've heard already. First, is that the tax deductions tend to disproportionately benefit people with larger income who pay a higher marginal tax rate, while tax credits, especially refundable credits, offer the same dollar benefits for all taxpayers and are more accessible to lower income tax filers. So why is this? Deductions are expenses that are subtracted from a person's taxable income. Each year, as taxpayers, we choose whether to take the standard deduction, which is a fixed dollar amount determined by the IRS, or to itemize and claim various specific deductions for specific things. Only 13% of households earning under $50,000 a year itemize. So this is not a great way to reach lower income households. And as Lewis talked about, tax credits, on the other hand, directly reduce the amount of tax a person owes, not their taxable income. Credits are sometimes provided as a flat dollar amount, like the child tax credit or a proportion of a subsidized activity, for example, child care and education expense credits. But refundable tax credits are the key for reaching lowest income households. The refundable credits are an effective way to bring tax benefits to low-income households because they have very little or no tax liability. Non-refundable tax credits can reduce the taxes a person owes to zero, but when the tax credits are refundable and there is a balance that exceeds the amount of the taxes a person owes, this amount becomes a cash payment from the IRS to the tax filer. The earned income tax credit is the largest refundable tax credit. Another key strategy for aligning asset building tax incentives with low and moderate income households is to create programs that have an automatic enrollment. We know from behavioral economics research that when people are required to opt out of savings programs rather than opt in, the participation goes up dramatically. The idea of creating automatic enrollment retirement saving strategies has growing bipartisan support. The Obama administration's new MyRA account is an example, and California's Secure Choice Retirement Program is another. Lastly, we know that from more than two decades of successful match saving programs in the asset building field, that low-income people can and do put money aside in savings to achieve important goals. Providing a financial match makes a huge difference, both in inspiring people with very limited resources to prioritize savings and making helping their savings grow more rapidly. We need to build on this track record of success in the asset building field and structure tax incentives for critical savings investments with a similar match incentive. Providing seed funding and saving matches for child savings accounts is one idea that's gaining some political traction. So, one second. These core principles and tax reform strategies are a piece of the work accomplished by the Tax Policy Project, which is a coalition of organizations that came together in 2012 to build a broad consensus on the tax reform agenda. The goal of the coalition is to shift more of the benefit of asset building tax subsidies down to lower income households and households of color. The Tax Policy Project was initiated by the Asset Funders Network, but it is a broad coalition of groups that started with 35 organizations, very diverse folks from academia, the asset building field, tax reform, base building organization, and intends to grow significantly in the year to come. Heather McCullough is our director, and most recently we shifted the leadership of the steering committee to PolicyLink and CFED, who are the new co-hosts. The group spent the last year and a half in conversation with one another, looking at research on tax reform strategies, developing the principles I spoke to earlier, and also a set of concrete policy tax reform options that all 35 organizations came to agreement would advance the goal of expanding asset building opportunities for low-income people. Moving forward, this coalition will continue to work collaboratively, continue to grow, but the focus will become increasingly on communications. How do we talk to the public, the constituencies, both in the membership of our organizations, but the general taxpaying community at large about these issues? We'll work on stakeholder engagement and coordinating advocacy efforts among the group. So with that, I think I will hand it back to Heather, and happy to answer any other questions.
Great. Thank you so much to all the presenters. So we're getting a ton of great questions flowing in, and I'm going to start off with a question for everyone. So if the speakers could please unmute themselves. So the first question, I'm going to make this a two-part one because I think you all could answer it together. So we heard about some of the policy opportunities and ways to change the tax code so low-income households and families of color could benefit. But give us a sense of what the opportunities might be moving forward to advance some of these policies. And as you talk about the opportunities, if you could give folks some of your thoughts on how local advocates and policymakers and local policymakers can engage, that would be helpful. So let me just open it up. Who wants to take that one?
Hi, Heather, this is Jeremy. I can jump in and start it off. I think that the second part of your question is really important because so the tax code was last reauthorized in a comprehensive way in the 80s. But since then, a lot of the tax code is, changes have been made kind of on this episodic way ever since then, like bills here, bill there. And essentially that is all in mass brought together what we have today, which is the tax code that everyone's talked about. Here in Washington, typically the way this is done is, it's a very inside baseball, inside Washington process where, the lobbyists drive the discussion, the corporations, the people that are looking to benefit from the tax code drive the discussion. And I think for us to really get to a point, of turning an upside down code right side up, that's a big lift and really means changing the conversation. And I think that conversation can only change outside of the Beltway. And I think it's going to take people in communities across the country engaging sympathetic public officials here in Washington, challenging those that may not be or are on the fence, and really begin to drive a narrative that if the tax code is to make these social policy changes in this country in the way of helping people build wealth and assets, it has to do it for those who need the most help. It can't continue to do it for people, as Amanda said that would save, invest in retirement, homeownership, things. People that would do that stuff anyways. That's not who these benefits should be for. It's for people that need assistance or need support from government to do it.
So Heather, this
great.
Is
great. Thanks, Jeremy.
Heather, this is Ben. I see two big opportunities, one at the state level and another at the federal level. At the state level, over the past few years, the big action has been on automatic enrollment. So California was a leader with their Secure Choice Plan. I think Amanda noted that. Yesterday, I haven't got an update yet, but the Illinois Senate had some votes this week that made their automatic enrollment plan come much closer to law. But basically, states have taken the lead on this. It's been in the president's budget and some congressional bills, but states have taken the lead on acknowledging that there are serious barriers, practical barriers to saving, that saving is difficult for people, that it's very confusing, that sometimes people might put off saving. And so moving forward, there's a real opportunity for states to take up these automatic enrollment programs and help people more easily take advantage of all of these incentives for saving. The second area, and maybe it's sort of, I'm being overly optimistic here, the second area for reform is in the mortgage interest deduction and subsidizing homeownership. One of the biggest questions when it comes to tax policy, and one of the reasons we don't see more movement in Washington, is because Republicans and Democrats fundamentally disagree on the level of taxes that should be collected. One of the nice things about the mortgage interest deduction and the tens of billions of dollars we spend every year subsidizing homeownership in this ineffective way is that if we can just accept the amount we spend through the tax code is given, many people in Washington, D.C. acknowledge that it can be done in a better way. Democrats and Republicans say, look, even if we spend these tens of billions of dollars a year subsidizing homeownership, let's just take that amount and do it in a better way. And so when I talk to congressional staff offline,
there is a real interest in making the mortgage interest deduction a better incentive for homeownership. So, you know, we can take this amount of money and we can do it either through annual tax credit for mortgage interest, or as some people know from a paper which came out earlier this year that got a fair amount of attention, we can just divorce the subsidy for homeownership from borrowing for homeownership altogether. So we give a tax credit every year for a child tax credit. You could imagine a similar strategy just for owning a home. Or I think as Lewis mentioned, we could have a homeownership credit that applied when you purchased the home to help people with buying a home for the first time. But the point is, I see two big strategies moving forward. One is the state level initiatives to help people save through automatic enrollment, and the second is for finding better homeownership subsidies.
Great, thank you so much. Did someone else want to answer? Sorry,
yeah,
I thought I heard someone speaking up.
Do you mind
go
if
ahead,
I chime
Liz.
In? Or, yeah. So,
just
to answer, so I think Jeremy and Ben did a good job on this with the first part of your question about what the opportunities are. Although I'll say that I think there will be an opportunity to have a conversation about the way the tax code should look as we approach the 2017 when the earned income tax credit and the child care tax credit are set to not expire, but some of the provisions that are very beneficial to low-income households are set to revert to something that's less beneficial. The second thing, in terms of what local advocates could do, what I would say is, you know, the two things. One is to continue to educate yourselves about the tax code, about tax subsidies, and the inequities in the tax code. And we started that process here. Second, take part in these national conversations about the tax code. And that's a way to educate yourself. And once we start to get a handle on what the tax code is, what these issues are, that even though it can be very complicated, at its essence, what we're talking about is there's a pot of money that's going to folks who don't need it. And there may be ways to make sure that we create an equitable tax code that makes sure that the distribution is more efficient and to make sure that those who do need it can get it. And so I think we have to talk about these things in real terms. Local advocates should talk about these things in real terms. We should talk about, you know, how expanding the EITC can lift millions more out of poverty. We could talk about how we should have a tax code that makes sure that if people are moving from job to job, as low-income households tend to do, that they can continue to save for retirement, that the ball doesn't drop in between jobs. We can make sure that we have a tax code that helps low-income first-time home buyers, as Ben said. So we need to talk about these things in real terms. We need to talk about the money that's being put in people's pockets or not being put in people's pockets to make sure that we are translating this in a way that motivates the local advocates and motivates the policymakers to action.
Great. Thank you, Lewis. I have two questions related to how people of color do or don't benefit from tax subsidies, and as we heard, don't benefit from many of them. The first one is sort of a clarifying question, Ben. What did the research show in terms of the Native data? How do American Indians, Alaska Natives, and Native Hawaiians benefit from the policies you've looked at, the EITC and the mortgage interest deduction? Do you have that specific data?
So I'm looking at, I mean, it's difficult to tell from, I have the charts, but sometimes from charts it's hard to read percentages. But it's pretty clear that that population does not benefit from the mortgage interest deduction hardly at all. It's a pretty clear story.
Yeah. And on that note, someone else was asking, to what degree do you think people of color, households of color, are aware of potential tax subsidies or not? So I think, Lewis, this is probably one for you, or Jeremy, for you. What are your thoughts on that?
Right. So, I think that we didn't look at that in the primer, but I would say that there probably is a lot of work to do to educate folks about the various tax subsidies that are available to them. You know, we already know that the EITC, there's less take up there are more people eligible for it than actually claim it, right? And so, I haven't seen any data on how many households of color are aware or not aware of it, but I would assume that there are a fair amount who aren't aware of the tax subsidies that are available to them.
Can I make a comment on that?
Yeah, Amanda, I'm going to have you jump in and then Jeremy.
Sure. I think this is a dynamic with all social policy. Step one is we need to align the incentives and opportunities appropriately. And step two is then always public education. Well, it doesn't matter if it's the tax code or the opportunity to apply for food stamps or whatever it is. There's no fault to folks for not knowing or underutilizing. I think in all social policy, there's a two-phase process. Change the policy, do the outreach. And when we think about implementing positive change in the code, I think we need to have a longer view that recognizes there's an implementation phase involved.
Yeah, and the only thing I'd add is, can I go, Heather?
No, go ahead, Jeremy.
Hi, it's Jeremy. Yep. So the only thing I add to that is that, you know, one of the things that contributes to the upside-down nature of the tax code is the extent to which people get support from experts in filling out their tax returns every year. So what we know is the wealthier people who have more resources are able to hire experts and people to help them comb out of the tax code these buried incentives and these buried benefits. I mean, they're really, really, you know, buried deep in the code. And what we know is that a lot of the lower income you are, the less access you have to that. And, you know, one of the programs that is provided that for low-income people is a volunteer income tax assistance program, or known as VITA. And, you know, that's a $12 million program, a very small program, but the amount of money it leverages every year and the amount of dollars it puts back in people's pockets that goes back into the economy is significant. Anyone that's been here in D.C. and seen the tax prep center at the Martin Luther King Library and seen the line that goes around the block can see that there's clearly a demand and people, a set of people that are aware. It's just that the resources to get the experts to people to help them fill out those forms so they can fully benefit just isn't really there in a lot of communities.
Great. And on that note, I'm going to have to wrap us up here. Thank you so much to our presenters and to everyone for participating. Really quickly, you're going to get a pop-up survey momentarily. If we didn't get to your question, feel free to put it in the comments section and I'll get back to you. And then you're also going to get a follow-up email probably early next week with the recording of the webinar, the PowerPoints, and a link to all the resources. So again, thanks everyone for being a part of this. We will be continuing this conversation and we look forward to your engagement. Thank you very much.